Catherine, thank you very much. Alec, Jared, Trevor, thank you very much for joining us. And kind of hard to believe we're on the six-year anniversary of you guys winning two cups in 3 years in L.A. Hope you guys are safe and healthy, and your families as well. Thanks a lot for joining us here on NBC's Hockey Happy Hour. And here we are back in L.A. for Game 5. You guys won the first three games of the series and then lost Game 4. Kind of what was your mindset going into that Game 5 at home? Jared, I'll start with you.
Well, I think from the first round against San Jose, I think we realized how serious and how important this game was. And a lot of times I believe in a long series. I know Game 7 is the most important game if it's a long series, but Game 5 I think is huge. And we did not want to go back to New York for Game 6. They would have all the momentum. And, you know, obviously the longer the series goes, they got the momentum if, you know, when we're up 3-0. So very important game here.
Hey, Trevor, Jared had mentioned about earlier in the playoffs, you guys had played three straight seven-game series. And everybody remembers round one against the San Jose Sharks when you guys were down 3-0. You guys were there 2 years prior when you won the Stanley Cup. The confidence that you guys had after accomplishing what you did in round one, and here you are 60 minutes away, at least you thought anyways, until you get to overtime for winning your second Stanley Cup in 3 years.
Yeah, I mean, we were just trying to, like Stoli said, we were just trying to win this game. I mean, the last thing we wanted to do was fly all the way back to New York, and you know, it really helped that we had been there before, and we had a confident group, and you know, the energy of the building starting off was unbelievable, and you know, the adrenaline was going, and we were ready to go.
Hey, Alec, coming off that seven-game series against the Chicago Blackhawks, where, as Catherine just set up for us, you scoring that OT winner there. What is that like in the locker room, knowing that the Stanley Cup is in the building, and you know, the talk amongst the guys, and you know, is it? I mean, Jared and Trevor mentioned it about, hey, you know what? You guys didn't want to go back to New York. Is that something that was said actually verbally, or that just stuff that was talked about inside that locker room?
I don't know if it was necessarily anything that we talked about verbally. I think that there might actually be a, you know, kind of a precedent on not talking about the fact that the Cup is in the building. I think, you know, in playoff series like that, the fourth win is the hardest one to get. And, you know, there weren't any dummies in that locker room. We knew what was at hand. And, you know, I think that if you kind of get too focused on the fact that the Cup is in the building and you have an opportunity to win it, then, you know, sometimes that can get the best of you. So you try to treat it like any other game and, you know, try to get the thing done.
Besides winning, I'll throw it out to anybody. What do you guys remember about that series against the Rangers?
Well, I guess I'll go on this one. I remember their speed. I think that was something that I know as a team, if we had struggled against any team, I think it was a team that had a lot of speed and, you know, their quick ups through the neutral zone. I know Alain Vigneault, that was his kind of style, just to throw pucks up. And we played Vancouver a couple of years ago in round one in 2012, and that's kind of how they played. So, yeah, we had to match that, and they got out to some leads. They got us game one and game two. They were up 2-0 at Staples Center. So we really had to come back in a lot of these games, and we just showed that resiliency and the type of lineup we had, the type of guys we had. And Jonathan Quick was not going to give up that third goal to, you know, for us to go down 3-0, because that was, you know, that obviously that's huge, and everyone knows a 2-0 lead versus a 3-0 lead is very, very tough to come back from, and Quickie just wouldn't let that happen.
So you guys are on a power play here. Both teams' power plays had struggled going into this Game 5. Trevor, Jared, you guys are known for PK type of guys. Any reason why you think the penalty killers had the better of the power play in this Stanley Cup final?
I mean, it's just, I think it's just being desperate. I mean, on the PK, it's getting in lanes and taking away seams. And I thought both teams did a pretty good job of that and weren't going to let any easy ones in.
Yeah, I think just little details are magnified. And, you know, it's, to be honest, I think it's easier to kill a penalty than to, you know, score a power play goal. And, percentages show that. And sometimes you try to do a little bit too much. And here you see Dewey just taking a simple shot. And maybe in the regular season, that's not a shot he would take. But, you know, you just got to get the puck to the net. And you never know what happens.
Hey, Alec, you were the one that just passed that puck over to Drew Doughty there. When you're watching this, I guess let me ask you this first. Have you guys gone back individually and A, have you watched Game 5 in its entirety? And how many times have you each watched it? Because there's nothing better. And look, I was lucky enough to be a very small part of the team way back in 1994 with the New York Rangers of winning a Stanley Cup in New York for the first time in 54 years. But, you know, you guys go back and love to live what happened, you know, almost 6 years ago.
I mean, I think that I've seen clips here and there, but to be honest, I don't think I've ever actually sat down and watched the entire thing. So a lot of this is, you know, I'm seeing plays and reminded of certain things and big moments in the hockey game that, you know, I might have forgotten about. But, you know, kind of just touching on that PK thing, I think one thing, too, is, you know, a team doesn't get to the final without having really good special teams. And obviously we're very fortunate to have guys like Stoli and Louis on the team getting in lanes and blocking shots and sacrificing their body. And I think New York had much of the same. So I think that's, you know, that had a lot to do with the fact that the power plays are struggling. Thrown back by Stepan, retrieved by Nash, spun wide,
Kreider there, around and fed one just away from Stepan. And we talked about the goaltending a little bit earlier. You guys talked about Quickie and Jonathan Quick. I mean, the goaltending in this series was absolutely, it was outstanding. I mean, in Game 3, I don't know if you guys remember this, but in Game 3, the Rangers outshot you guys 32-15, and you guys won at Game 3 nothing. And then in Game 4, you guys outshot the Rangers in New York, have a chance to win the Stanley Cup. You outshot them 41-19, including 15-1 in the third period. And you guys lost that game, and then obviously here we are in Game 5. Can you guys just touch on the goaltending at either end from what you remember, not only with Jonathan Quick, but also Henrik Lundqvist?
I remember Game 3 in New York. That was Quickie's. I don't know, you guys can maybe have your opinion obviously as well, but I think that was Quickie's one of his best games of his career as a teammate of his. You know, he first Stanley Cup final at MSG in a long time. Obviously, Eddie, you were there the last game, and you know, Quickie just, he was so simple, so solid right from the start. I remember he made a save on Matt Zuccarello with his paddle. It was an easy goal for Zuccarello, and I you know, can only imagine what he felt like at the time. But Quickie just on the bench, I was like, how the heck did he save that? You know, we say that a lot, you know, playing with him. But, you know, Mike Richter was an idol of his. And I think that maybe a little added incentive there. And Quickie coming in just wanted to play well. And I think that was his best game of his career, one of them.
Trevor, how about Henrik Lundqvist?
Yeah, I mean, he was solid. I mean, you obviously have to have good goaltending to get to the finals. And, it seemed like... you know, he didn't give up too many second chances. Everything that was getting to him was kind of swallowed up. So I think we made a point of trying to take his eyes away and, you know, get those second chances when we could. But, you know, say something about Jonathan Quick is if I ever needed a goalie for a seven-game series, I'd pick Jonathan Quick every time. I mean, he's the most competitive guys that I know. And it seems like when the game's on the line, he's always at his best.
Hey, Stoli, you want to break this goal down by Justin Williams?
Hacking it. Well,
nowadays,
Stoli.
You know what? Nowadays, this goal might not have counted, to be honest with you. I think I push Henrik into the net pretty good here. I was just trying to find the puck. Me and Dwight King, I think we were doing the same thing. And yeah, we were just, it was just a battle in front of the net. A great shot by Willie Mitchell, just getting it through. Very, very hard
hack
to get pucked through. Hack and whack.
Well, even though
we did best, day, Louis?
Justin here, Williams easy, scores a big goal in a big game. Weird.
You're watching Hockey Happy Hour, presented by Jersey Mike Subs.
Well, we're going to fast forward into this game, guys. You were talking about Justin Williams. This is out for anybody. Always seems to step up in the biggest stages in his entire career. As you see, you guys are going to be shorthanded here. King with a high stick on Zuccarello. But Justin Williams always seems to be able to step up throughout his NHL career.
Yeah, he's not Mr. Game 7 for nothing. It seems like he's probably one of the most clutch players to ever play. I mean, and his leadership off the ice is pretty unbelievable, too. When something needs to be said, he can say it. And it seems like every big moment he steps up and makes a big player, scores a big goal for us.
He just wants to be that player. Go ahead, Murray.
No, I was just thinking, you know, I know this was kind of going back to 2012, but, you know, at that point, he was one of the only guys, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, on the team that had won a cup before. And so it kind of touches on the leadership that Louis just mentioned. I mean, you can't say enough about the guy. The guy comes up huge in big-time situations and big games and you know, I think that was obviously evident in the fact that he won the Conn Smythe. And, you know, I think that he just provided a little bit of that extra leadership and experience of having been in these situations before. Again, I know we were there a couple years prior, but, you know, his leadership qualities are unmatched.
You guys break down this goal here coming up. I think there's a goal coming up.
me and Louis were fine up top there. I don't know.
Yeah. I could just hear Greener
classic,
yelling pack.
Classic forward. Classic forwards just passing the buck onto the D.
Careful, Alec. I carry that forward member's card for the union as well. So
yeah, I know.
Three against one.
Yeah, exactly.
So.
Yeah.
This is a heck of a play here. Yeah. Heck of a play by the Rangers, though. They really did a nice job here.
Condensed game. I thought we'd fast forward this, but yeah, they do. That's a tough play for anybody. Look at that pass, though. That's
unbelievable.
That goes
pass,
through
yeah.
a couple sticks. That's a couple inches, and yeah, there's not much you can do on this one here for any of us.
How important was a guy like Willie Mitchell or a guy like Robin Regier, who was there as well? You talked about veteran guys, leaders in that locker room. Regier hurt towards the end here, not able to play in this game five, but. You know, you guys, veteran guys, but at that time, you know, a little bit younger, Alec and Trevor, Jared, you've been around the block a few times. Just the experience factor of getting guys inside that room that have kind of been through the so-called wars of the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Well, I think we were talked about as being a tough team to play against, and you got guys like Willie Mitchell and Robin Regier back there. Those are two guys, Mac Green, like especially those three. Those aren't guys I'd want to play against, especially in the playoffs. You know, try to get the puck through against those guys, to go into the corner against those guys. It's just, those were characters and guys that were huge in the locker room, but on the ice, they would do anything to win, and they showed it. And I'm so happy for Robin, too. Robin's played a lot of years and a lot of games, a lot of hard games. And for him to win a cup was pretty special to see.
Looking at the birthday boy, Ryan McDonagh. I don't know if you guys realize this, but this game was on a Friday. It was in June, and was Friday the 13th. It was the only Friday the 13th in the entire 2014 calendar, and not a good birthday for Ryan McDonagh, but a great day for you guys and your fans and your ownership on Friday the 13th. I don't know if you guys realize that on that day, but lots of positive karma there for the Kings winning your second cup in 3 years on Friday the 13th of 2014.
Did not realize that at the time, that's for sure. No, I don't think we would have wanted to think about that.
Yeah.
Well, we are creatures of habit, right, Stoley? I mean, whatever happens, if you win, you drive to the same way to the rink. I want to ask you guys about that play. Jonathan Quick goes out there trying to help the defense back there. At some point, do you just tell the goaltenders to stay in their net and let the defensemen worry about those pucks there?
I mean, I guess I'll speak up as the defenseman. I mean, sometimes it depends on how well the goalie seems to be feeling the puck that night. But no, I mean, obviously, I think that, you know, it's definitely a big part of today's game. There's a lot of goaltenders that are really good at playing the puck. And and take a lot of pride in it. And you know, when you're on and you're communicating and executing, I mean, it's you can treat it almost as another defenseman. You know, there's, like I mentioned, there's a lot of goalies that can make a lot of really good plays, and you know, if you're able to have an extra guy back there, and even if he's just talking, sometimes it's not even necessarily making the play itself. It's, you know, just letting me know where to put the puck, and you know, just an extra voice out there, and the extra communication helps out a lot. But yeah, I mean, anytime Quickie wants to come out and help me play a puck so I don't get put into the first row, then I'll gladly welcome that.
Hey, Eddie, we just saw a great clip of Kyle Clifford there. Sorry.
I saw that too.
Oh, yeah. I almost stopped talking.
That was nice.
That's Cliffy's patented move there.
It doesn't matter a million times in practice.
He talked about the heaviness of your team. Certainly he was an important part for the run that you guys had as well. I mean, Kyle Clifford, a real big body and awesome offensive skill as well, and taking that puck to net, not an easy guy to play against, that's for sure.
Yeah, he might not see the guy on the backside, but he'll drop the shoulder. And,
yeah, he'll take it to the net every time, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Oh, I got to get out.
No, I think you kind of touched on that too with our, you know, like Willie Mitchell and Matt Green and Robin Regier. It's guys like Cliffy, you know, it's those guys that play physical over the course of a seven-game series. And, you know, obviously when you make it to the final, you've had three rounds before that, that every bump and every hit, those certainly add up. And I think that was part of the reason why we had success as a team, is that we played physically and we could just grind some teams down. But those guys undoubtedly have a huge impact in the series. And, you know, just those little bumps, those add up.
Hey, Stoley, you're in the broadcast business here. You want to break down this penalty on Dominic Moore here?
That was, to be honest,
it's coming.
Kind of
it's coming.
It's coming. Weird one.
Left part of your screen here. Watch this. Watch the left part of your screen here. Watch this.
I'll be honest. That's a weak call. I'll be honest. In the Stanley Cup Finals in Game 5, that's probably not a call, but.
You guys were probably feeling pretty good about this opportunity here, right? You guys remember what's going on right now?
I know what happened.
Anybody know what's coming?
2 minutes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
One of our ex-teammates.
Yeah. I remember this.
Yeah, Brian Boyle made a huge play there. A couple of shot blocks and on the verge of putting himself in the highlight reel, that's for sure.
Yeah, like we score here, and that's pretty good momentum to end the second period. And obviously, it goes the other way. But Henrik Lundqvist was so good in this game. I remember we put so many pucks at him, and you know, he was seeing everything, smothering everything, and playing desperate. Carl doesn't get up, but Henrik Lundqvist
bails his countryman Hagelin out. So when you're playing against a goaltender like this in this setting, guys, like what's the chatter on the bench, like amongst yourselves and your coaches, and you know, just like what is the verbiage there going on there, even though you guys haven't been able to find the back of the net, and you guys have had a plethora of opportunities.
I think it's just you know, keep shooting and try to take his eyes away as much as possible, because. A lot of times, if he can't see it, you know, there's going to be a second chance or third chance, and we're just trying to find any hole and take his eyes away and get any of those ugly ones we could.
Just getting shots off quick too. I think just try not to make the perfect play, and you know, very rarely in this Stanley Cup Finals are you going to see, or you know, later on in games you're going to see the perfect play or the backdoor tap in. A lot of times goals now are scored just on quick releases and not giving a goaltender a chance to set up, and you find a hole and you score a goal. But it's tough. Goalies are good now.
Yeah, I think when you play a goaltender like that who's hot and making a lot of big saves, I think, you know, it's just human nature to get frustrated, and you try to change you know, kind of what you're doing. But I think you have to be reminded, and I think that goes into some of the chatter that we heard on the bench, is you know, just keep doing the same thing. Eventually something's, you know, something's going to squeak. You're going to get a break, but.
How about this break here for the Rangers coming up?
Yeah, I don't love this play here. This is,
That was a hell of a move there by Boyle. Wow, what a goal. What a goal for sure.
That was a great move and an even better shot for sure.
Those are a lot of the things we teach young guys now coming up in the organization to that deception. I think we'll probably hopefully see a good replay here. Just that deception that Boiler shows. And he's going against Drew here, and there's not much Drew can do on this one. You know, I don't think it goes off his stick. It looks like it's pretty close, but that's just a great shot, right?
Yeah, he froze Doughty on that one replay. He just kind of froze him a little bit. And Alec, you can speak to this being a defenseman, but you know, once you can freeze a guy and he's not moving, then all of a sudden you can just get that, you know, get that separation. And with that big body of Boyle, he made a heck of a shot. And you know, I think Jonathan Quick was anticipating that puck going down low. So you guys missed an opportunity on a power play, and then you give up a shorthanded goal here very, very late in game five. We're going to have a TV timeout here coming up in a short period of time. But just what's the initial quick thought, Jared, of what the feeling's like on the bench right now, you guys down by one late in the second?
You know what? We're fine. I do remember this moment pretty clearly, and there were so many times in the course of the playoffs where we've been down, and you know, including games one and two at home here as well. So, we're fine. To be honest, it sucked. Gave up that goal late. It's, you know, the momentum swing. Some teams would be deflated by that, but I don't think we were. Now you see a shift where me and Louie, look at that, Lou balls.
Yeah, buddy.
All right, guys, we're going to take another TV timeout, and you're watching the 2014 Stanley Cup Final, Game 5, Kings and Rangers. Well, welcome back to NBC's Hockey Happy Hour. I'm Eddie Olczyk, along with Alec Martinez, Jared Stoll, and Trevor Lewis of the Los Angeles Kings. Well, guys, you gave up the shorthanded goal late in that second period. You're down 2-1. You're up 3-1 in a series. What was the message coming from Daryl Sutter and the leadership inside that room? Trevor, I'll start with you.
I mean, it was just, I think it was keep going. I mean, I think we've been playing well. We've been putting a lot of pucks at the net and, you know, just keep it simple and shoot the puck and never know what's going to happen. And, you know, we had a lot of guys on the team that have been there and done it before. And obviously we've been through three game sevens already. So, I think we were ready to go and just ready to come out firing.
Well, we fast forward to this third period to about 5 or 6 minutes in. I don't know if you guys realize this, but Rangers actually went like 12 minutes of the third period without getting a shot on goal. Was that something you guys had felt or recognized on the bench in this third period? Alec, did you guys realize that, or is that something you guys, you know, just kind of don't look at until you hear about it after the game?
I think it kind of depends on how the game flows. I think, you know, obviously we were buzzing. We had some momentum. I'd say the one guy that notices it the most is probably Quickie.
Right.
He's probably sitting back there, you know, trying not to get cold. But, you know, I don't think that it's necessarily something you talk about on the bench, but I think we had a lot of momentum, and that's something that you feel. You know, as you're playing, you know, there's going to be momentum swings. And, you know, I know that we came out and, you know, we were buzzing.
Here's a great chance. Willie Mitchell with a chance. I thought Kopitar might shoot that puck, but threw it back to Voyanov back at the point. And Lundqvist again with another brilliant stop here in game five.
I think also, Eddie, was like in the third period here, Daryl Sutter, he was a guy that we played everybody. And, you know, a lot of times in the, you know, you'll see a lot of different line combinations here going on. He had the bingo ball machine going some games just to, you know, that's why he was so good in the playoffs and matching up. And, you know, he would always tell us just before each series, and, you know, he'd look at the opposing lineup and see a player that maybe was similar to me and have a conversation with me and saying, you got to win your battles against him. You got to outplay him this series. And he would do that with all of us. And that was something that I think each of us took a lot of pride in. And we just, you know, we wanted to win that battle. And whether it was Kopitar against, you know, Stepan or me against Moore, whatever the case may be, it was just to win that battle. And I think that's why we just kept pushing and pushing. We played everybody. He played everybody.
Hey, Alec, you guys really have the momentum here. We just showed that chance for Mitchell and Voyanoff on the back end. The crowd is into it at this time. Can you kind of feel the momentum starting to come to your side of the ice? And here's another chance right off that faceoff after Alain Vigneault used the timeout shot from Muzzin on the point.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I think it's kind of like what I mentioned earlier. It's, you know, you feel that energy. You feel it from the crowd. You feel it from, you know, the guys. You feel it from the game. And, you know, we were, you know, give Lundqvist a lot of credit. I mean, he weathered a pretty big storm. I mean, we were throwing a lot at him. And obviously these, I mean, we keep seeing save after save that he made. And not just the initial save, but second and third chances. I mean, I'm no goalie, but, you know, those are really difficult to defend as a defenseman. So I can only imagine, you know, what it was for him. But, yeah, I mean, I think that we're definitely starting to feel it here.
Here's our break.
Ooh, yeah.
Yeah, I was working this game as we talked about a little bit earlier, and I thought this could have been a penalty on Muzzin or just let him play and ended up calling it on Zuccarello here. You guys can talk about it as this play develops.
I think Muzz is trying to go to the left there. I don't, well, you know, his leg is out a little bit, but I understand what you're saying about just let us play. Looks like he's trying to go to the left a little bit, but yeah, it's a tough.
It's an opportunity, right? The door opened up, and you go to your big boys, and Alec, you're out here on this power play.
Yeah, I think obviously, you know, it's this is a big opportunity here, and I mean, there kind of what we said earlier. I mean, Stoli and Louis mentioned that is, I mean, that wasn't that pretty. It was a shot to the net and a rebound, and that's the kind of thing that you got to keep doing. And you know, I think that it would have been pretty easy for us to try to get fancy, but you know, you look at this. I mean, it's a D-to-D pass. It's a shot. It's low. It's not, you know, you're not trying to go high. Just create a second opportunity, and obviously Gabby came up huge. I mean, I think he had what 14 or 15 goals this playoff. You know, and that was obviously a huge, huge momentum swing for us. Even just tying the game, you know, that's a big, big, big momentum swing.
And so quickly too, right into the power play as well. You guys had the momentum. The Rangers still not having a shot on goal, and next thing you know, the puck goes from one side of the ice to the other, and Gabrick, another tremendous pickup by Dean Lombardi, and ties it up at two. And now I got to imagine you guys are feeling like King Kong out there right now with all the momentum at Staples Center.
Yeah, I mean, it was really loud in there too, and you know, get that tying goal was a huge, huge thing for us. And you know, now we just gotta play and try to get the next one too.
I think for them, they're also thinking now, like, hey, we give up the next one here and we could lose this series. And for us, you know, we're just, I remember, I think I took that faceoff after we scored there. And I remember that being one of the loudest I've heard Staples Center, because I think the crowd, they could feel it too. They know we get one more. You know, I think there's 10 minutes left in this game, 12 minutes left. And, you know, the crowd too, they're feeling it. We're feeling it. And, you know, there you go. Shots this period, 6-0. So, you know, we're playing our game here.
Well, this is really the first amount of pressure that the Rangers had, really, in the first half of this third period. You guys just absolutely smothered them, and I don't want to say they were sitting back trying to protect the lead, but certainly you guys dictated the terms and got back to, you know, got back to even with more than half the game or half the third period to go for the opportunity to win. win the Stanley Cup. All right, guys, we're going to take another TV timeout. Everybody, I hope you're watching Game 5 of the 2014 Stanley Cup Final between the Kings and the Rangers. Well, as we fast forward to the first overtime, guys, just what do you remember about going in from regulation into overtime and kind of the conversation inside that room and the mindset you guys had, even though you had, you know, won before and been through three straight series with game sevens in the first three rounds to getting to game five in the Stanley Cup Final?
Oh, I think just let's get it done. Let's finish it off. You know, short shifts. You know, good sticks, I think, too. You don't want to take a penalty, an easy penalty, in a situation like this, and just rolling them over. I think that was our thing, like I said earlier with Daryl, the way he coached. We just played everybody, and, you know, you keep that pace and tempo high. And, you know, I know as the longer the game went on here, it's, you know, the pace is going to drop a little bit. But, you know, we just, by playing everybody, we just wanted to keep it rolling.
You know, as a broadcaster, you know, I make a lot of the long changes in the second period, and then once you get to overtime like this, is that something that you guys consistently talk about, you know, on the bench, or the reminders come from the coach of how important it is that those changes, because your defensive zone's the farthest away from your bench? Alec, I'll give that one to you.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's definitely something that you talk about. You know, I think that kind of touching on what Stoley said and rolling them over and being smart with your sticks. I think you got to play smart in general, and that's definitely a part of doing that. I think, you know, as a D-man, you know, playing on that in this particular case, playing on that right side, it's pretty easy to get stuck out there and hemmed in. And you know, I think that you do want to keep your shift short. You want to sometimes you got to change a little bit before you really want to, or before you feel like you're ready. But kind of just piggybacking off what Stoley said. I mean, it's you got to play smart, and that's a big part of it. Coaches certainly, that's one of their favorite things to say, I'd say, you know, going out, you know, before the second period. You usually can put money on the fact that, you know, at least one of either the head coach or the assistant's going to say it. But, you know, and then obviously the situation being the same here in the first OT.
Well, you know what's going to happen when you don't mention it. Somebody's going to get caught and then make a change, and the puck's going to end up in the back of the net, right? That's just the reality. There's a great chance here right off the crossbar. You guys remember this in the first overtime?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I remember I don't know if Ty played a whole lot, and they came out there, and I was actually on the ice, and I thought it went in for a second, but it was a great shot by him. And I mean, what
I just gave you some credit there, Alec.
Whoa.
I just
there we go.
Boy, nice skate one way, there. Shoot back the other way, right?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Great shot too.
That was a really good shot.
That 70s line was pretty special for you guys, huh?
Yeah, they were.
Yeah, they were.
They were dynamic. I mean, they all could skate and shoot. They were goal scorers, so they were fun to watch, fun to play with.
Look at all the beards. Look at that, Louis.
Oh, Louis.
That was my dimple, boys.
Man, just a mountain man over there.
I got a dimple because of that one.
You got a big cut too, right?
Yeah. I think that happened in the third period of this game.
It's a warrior, Lou.
You just thought the ladies would think it'd be cute if you had a dimple. That was on purpose, huh?
I remember Drew was so mad that I got hit in the face with a stick and then got a dimple after it. He was jealous, I think.
I love seeing, like, the crowd standing, you know, the first 10 rows or whatever, just people so excited, just ready to roll, and if we scored, you know, it's just pretty cool to watch everybody standing. Wow, there's some good chances here.
Oh, that's a nice little whack by Kofi there.
I know.
That's a little gamesmanship.
Ended the game. Two chances for Matt Zuccarello. The first one is going to be a shot from Dan Girardi. He's going to shoot this puck, and it's redirected right there from Matt Zuccarello. And then Zuccarello gets it again. And John
Quickie got it with the blocker, I think.
Yeah.
Unbelievable opportunities, but again, generating.
There's just something about Quickie when he's on. He just has this, like, just has this presence about him, this look. And I mean, look at that.
That's
I think Pierre just mentioned it. I mean, that's pretty impressive.
Just makes himself big, you know, and I don't know if he saw that puck. It didn't look like he did, but, you know, he just made himself big and it hits him.
One that's carefully stopped and played in on an offside that's delayed by Girardi. Ahead now it comes to Jeff Carter. Carter trying to swagger by. Play around in front. Denied enough that he couldn't pull the trigger on the shot. On the check.
Carter's flying.
Here comes Carter again. But Kender is blocked away. Carter threw one off the back of the cage. Mike Richards able to step to that one. Laid it to the back. Doughty a shot. That one blocked down.
I remember this one.
What do you remember? Besides the
did
chance,
that go
like,
off
I mean,
a, did that go off a did that go off a bar or did he just miss that?
I think
wide?
He saved. I think he
the
saved.
Quickie made the save there.
Yeah.
I think it hit his blocker. I think. Yeah.
Oh, maybe there was another one. Didn't Kreider hit the post in double OT? Maybe that's the one I was thinking of.
He did have another breakaway. I forget which game it was, but yeah, you're right, Marty. He did. Yeah.
Yeah.
Seconds left, holding his stall. Through one that's blocked away by Carter.
I actually talked to him about that one at World Championships, and it was a pretty short conversation. Yeah.
Depending on how you're counting. Well, Chris Kreider made the play by blocking the shot, the little things, and not many players are going to be able to catch up to Chris Kreider. And what an arm save there by Jonathan Quick. Or maybe even off the blocker.
Yeah, it looks like it hit his blocker.
And Jeff Carter, a couple of good looks, great pass.
All right, guys, there's overtime number one. We'll get ready for overtime number two. You're watching the 2014 Stanley Cup Final Game 5 on NBC's Hockey Happy Hour. That was denied by Dan Girardi.
You're watching Hockey Happy Hour, presented by Jersey Mike Suggs.
Overtime number two. We're going to fast forward, guys. 8:30 left to go in overtime number two. Twos are wild. You guys played it, so I'm just going to listen to you guys talk about what's going on. So enjoy the memory.
Was looking for who he could pass to. Martinez denied him the puck. Strawman will chase this back down.
I think here, again, like in the first overtime or the longer the game goes, you just want to keep it simple. No turnovers, no penalties. You know, we'd always say get it in at their blue line, out at ours, in at theirs, and keep play a simple game and find a way.
Yeah, I think oftentimes in situations like that, if you just focus on playing well in your own end, you're obviously going to get opportunities the other way.
Oh, nice pass, Marty.
Even better move by Louie there.
I think I got a little lucky there. I think it hit a skate.
I think it hit the NBC Sports symbol in the corner there, Louie.
Yeah, it did.
little plug for NBC.
We're always looking for good analysts, Trev. We're always looking for good analysts. Take us through this, Trev. Take us through this play.
Yeah, I was just trying to chip it off the boards there, and it luckily hit a skate, but I was just trying to get it to the net there, and whoever that was had a good stick. I think that's Nash, actually. Kind of deflected it over to the NBC sign there.
Trevor Lewis into making that play a little bit quicker than maybe he would like. Girardi back to McDonough. And laid back, but as far as Doughty. Up loose and can be played across to Muzzin, and Muzzin rattles it back in. McDonough turns with it there. Bothered by Gabrick, shook it back up the boards. Brian Boyle, very responsible, popped it to center. Muzzin jabbed one along.
Huge hit in the middle.
That right there, I mean, that's it. That's a huge hit. I think that, you know, we talked about those three guys, Bregier, Michie, and Greener. But, you know, I think one guy you can't forget about and you just saw is evident right there is Muzzy. I mean, Muzzy plays a really – really physical game, and he's got a lot of big hits in his repertoire.
Marty St. Louis
And apparently Boyle does too.
And then the left part of your screen, here comes Drew Doughty. With the chance, Lundqvist perfectly positioned, no second chance opportunity.
What does a game look like that has 100 face-offs? Don't know until now. 51.
That's you, Stoli.
What does it look like, Stoli?
You took half.
No,
you took
I think
half.
I lose it. I think I lose it.
Yeah, all right. Good memory. Good memory.
Yeah.
Must have been a bad drop, huh? Often. Bad drop?
Yeah, it's always the linesman's fault. You're right. Oh, just see Hounding out there. If you're going to go in on the forecheck, just take everybody out, I guess.
After that massive collision down in the corner. It's almost like bowling for dollars. Mark Stahl wins the race. There's Stahl closing the gap. Nothing wrong there. And it looks like a skate comes up from his own man, White King. He makes a great feed.
Hey, look at that. You get a prime scoring opportunity. That's a good forecheck.
Muck it up,
yeah, just muck it up. Take out everybody.
Hey, can I ask you guys, are you nervous here? Is there nerves?
I mean, I think it's kind of a adrenaline going right now. I think just don't
you're
get caught
thinking,
out there.
You're not thinking. You're just playing. You're just playing.
Just, yeah. I mean, it's obviously been a long game, and we know we got a chance to win it all right here. And
you did right there, Louis.
Yeah.
Great play by Carter on the boards there to find you.
Nice pass.
I bet they're a little nervous, Eddie. Like you give up a goal and you lose the Stanley Cup.
Right.
I remember in 06, I played in Edmonton. It was overtime of Game 5, and we were killing a penalty. And if Carolina scored on the power play, they won. And I was so nervous, I just didn't want to make a mistake. I just didn't want to turn over the puck. And
there we go, boys.
I'll be quiet now.
I remember I went for a
I don't know about you boys, but I just got the chills there.
Yeah. I was going to say, I went for a line change there, and I didn't even get off the ice before he scored, so I was one of the first guys in with you.
Yeah. Did he get the plus?
I don't think so. I didn't look at a game.
Who cares?
Yeah, seriously.
I think an underrated part of that play is that defensive play that Greener made in front right before the rush started.
And then Trevor
and
had a nice quick little play there, Alec, interfering to allow Alec. We're going to get a replay. Look at this. Yeah. But Trevor kind of interferes a little bit with one of the Rangers. I'm not sure who it was. And that allowed Alec to jump into the play and create that 3-on-2. So a couple of really good defensive plays end up cashing in, and Alec puts the puck in the back of the net.
Yeah. What a feeling that was, huh, boys?
How good is it winning both at home, though, too? Winning in general obviously is great, but winning it for our fans and
pretty special.
Kind of waiting for this replay here.
This game 7 in overtime against Chicago, Marty. Hey, winning goal here.
Old hat there. Every dog. Old hat.
Yeah, even a blind squirrel finds a nut, boys. Every once in a while. I remember that scrum, obviously. It was pretty wild, but I remember not being able to breathe. You know, you're pinned up against the glass. And
here's the replay.
Everyone's yelling and screaming.
And you just want to find everybody, hug everybody, kiss everybody.
Yeah, seriously.
You're so exhausted, too. Like, 3 game 7s we played, and then all the double overtimes, and just finally take a breath.
What's that like to see that cup coming onto the ice and knowing that that's yours?
I just remember how shiny it was coming out. You look down and I didn't know how they were going to do it, how they were going to get it to center ice, but this is a pretty cool way to do it. That's a, it's a great song, too, for it.
I feel like I should be talking right now, but I don't really have anything to say. I'm just staring at it.
Never gets old seeing it, does it? When you know your name's on it, and it's going to be on it again.
Such a good-looking trophy. You know, I'm sure we're all biased, but it's got to be the best-looking in sports.
I think just the fact that there's only one.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember in 2014 compared to 2012, I think we were always our first time winning in 12, and we were so excited and ready to get after it. And this time it was kind of like, take a breath, enjoy it, relax, you know, watch everyone hold it. And it was just a special moment for sure.
Remember in the dressing room, boys, after 2012 in the dressing room, there was a ton of people in our room celebrating, and maybe people that shouldn't have been in there, some people, but after this game here in 2014, it was just the coaches, the players, and the trainers, and that was it. And we were just sitting in our stalls, just exhausted, and just looking at it, drinking, and just laughing with each other and hugging each other, and two totally different scenes, I remember.
Yeah.
Trying to wipe your eyes a lot with the stinging of the champagne. I think one of the things that we're about to see, I think he, after Brownie hoists it, is giving it to Reg. And I mean, I think that really at the end of the day, it's like the coolest part about winning this is seeing guys hoisted and being able to share that experience with people that you care about. I mean, I think Stoley mentioned it earlier, a guy like Reg who had played a lot of hard games, had a really long career, and you know, was never able to win until now, and just I think he's about to raise it now. I mean, seeing him and then Gabby as well hoisted, I mean, that's easily one of the coolest parts about this.
What is it? I think 34 pounds, something like that. But it weighs about 50, to be honest with you,
And you just don't want to be that guy who drops it, right?
Well, guys, really appreciate your time. Thank you very much for reminiscing about your Stanley Cup win back in 2014. And for Jared Stoll, Trevor Lewis, Alec Martinez, and Catherine Tappan, I'm Eddie Olczyk. Thank you very much for watching NBC's Hockey Happy Hour. Remembering the 2014 Stanley Cup champions, Los Angeles Kings.